Chris and Jason and Lanny from Mercer come and do a demonstration for us. Thank you for being here. It's Saturday morning, and I realize you're giving up some of your weekend to be here with us, but I think this is valuable knowledge and some skills, and we have some stones and things like that, so practice knife sharpening.
That's
right. All the best things, so I'll turn it over to Chris, and thank you.
Good morning. How are we?
Good.
Excellent. Welcome. So as Chef says, I work for Mercer Cutlery. We are the company that provides your knives to you. A little bit about us, just to kind of give you an idea of where we come from. We're about a 30-year-old cutlery company. We service primarily culinary schools in the United States, so we're really sort of a more of a student and chef-driven company. That's what we're interested in. We're not necessarily interested in selling a million knives to all the sort of commercial outlets in the world. Rather, we develop products that are for chefs, by chefs, if you will, that sort of idea. I have a couple of things that I want to go through with you today. As you said, we have some information about your knives, how they're made. I want to tell you a little bit more about them. Also, I want to do some handling, some safety stuff, and then really the most important is sharpness with the knives. So just give you a little background about myself. My name is Chris Parker. I've been in the restaurant business for just over 10 years now. I'm a graduate of culinary school. I went to the Midwest Culinary Institute in Cincinnati, Ohio. And then I've been living in New York City for the last 4 or 5 years working and cooking and being all restaurant-y there. I recently left a little James Beard-nominated restaurant in the West Village called Reset. We had the pleasure of being nominated one of the 30 best new restaurants in the country last year. And then our chef was also nominated for Rising Star Chef, which is sort of like a rookie of the year sort of thing. So it's nice to be able to just be out of the industry and be able to come and tell you a little bit more about what's going on with our products. Because I really believe in this. I think this is an excellent knife, and it's a good tool for you to have in the kitchen and at home and wherever you may be using it. I'm sure as chef may have told you that really your knife is your most important tool in your kit of culinary. So we want to make sure we know what's going on, how it's made, and really importantly how we handle it, we're safe with it, and how we sharpen it. So it's always a good, strong, best tool for you to use. So let's talk a little bit about that knife that you have in your kit. I believe it is this one. It's the Genesis knife here. This is a fully forged, high carbon stainless steel knife. So what does that mean? Basically that means this knife is fully forged. So it's one piece of steel, all the way from the tip of the blade, all the way to the butt end of the blade. This is all one piece. We find this gives superior balance, strength, and durability as far as knives go. But, you know, we've all had knives, but really I don't think too many of us have ever really thought about where our knife comes from. So I'd like to start with that as sort of our, just kick off the presentation so you get an idea of what's going on with it. So as I said, the knives are high carbon German stainless steel. Your knife starts out like this. This is a rectangular blank. This is the basis of the knife. I have a whole bunch of these ones I set for you. Basically what happens is we get sheets of stainless steel. Are the steel in our factory. They're cut to size, so as it'll come around to you, you'll see if that's the basic rough outline of your knife. From there, they go through a high heat tempering process. Basically, that blank is superheated. It's then pressed from both sides. That pressure produces this little bubble of steel here. This is going to be important for the bolster of the knife down the road. So as you see, it becomes, goes from being one piece a little bit smaller, a little bit denser, a little bit more compact. This is the next stage. This is the basic outline stamping of it. So you see that little bubble on there actually becomes the bolster of the knife, which is where a lot of the balance and the strength of the knife comes from. So you see that eventually this will be that eventually. So the next stage in knife production is we actually cut out the rough blank of the knife, which is what you see here. So the process is fairly simple. The machine comes down and it just cuts it into the rough shape that you see there. So that's you see the rough shape of the knife. And then it goes through a few more processes. So I don't know if anyone is familiar with how steel is actually made. Basically iron, a compound of iron is superheated, ultimately heated and cooled. The idea is that we're sort of purifying the iron and we're trying to remove as many of the other impurities from it as possible. Ideally, steel itself is an iron compound that has less than 2% carbon. I'll tell you a little bit more about this down the road, but what we're trying to do is basically we're trying to get something that's in a rough shape. At this point, this is right where we want it to be. It's considered machine steel, so it's not super hard. This is done so that it's a little bit more efficient to grind it into its shape of the knife. But from here, we have two final heating processes for it that gives it that hardness that's going to need to be performed in the kitchen. So as you see up on the screen, this is the first stage, is a high heat tempering process. We throw it through a 2,500 degree oven. What this does basically is the molecules in the steel will expand rapidly. This helps get the knife some of that important strength of the steel, which was really important as far as, number one, holding an edge, and then also being able to put a really sharp edge on it initially. So we start with this as sort of the final hardening process for the steel. And then after that, it goes into an annealing oven, which is the next stage. So after those molecules from the steel have been superheated and they've expanded, they go into a cooler oven that's about 600 degrees Fahrenheit. And what that does is then it allows the molecules to retract and crystallize. And what the idea is that the steel, the iron itself, is sort of a lattice structure. It's like a crystalline lattice structure. And then the carbon content in there forms little carbides. The easiest way to think of it is sort of like rebar in the concrete. The idea being is that it's reinforcing the metal itself from the inside, and this is really important as far as higher quality chef's knives go. So they hold an edge well, and they can be sharpened very well as well. So that's the sort of manufacturing process of it. From there, it moves into our robotic side of things, if you will. Our factory has sort of two sides to it. We have a robotic machine process for the actual manufacturing, which is important for keeping our costs down to make it more efficient so we can pass savings on to you. And then when the knives are finished, we actually hand finish all of our knives. So they're handled by a master craftsman who sharpened the knives by hand, which is important. So from there, the knife is going through basically a grinding and polishing stage where it starts to look like the outline of the knife itself. You see it gets that polish on it. The blade is thin. When you get the blanks, you'll see that the edge is very thick there, and actually this is the point where we're putting that sort of precision edge on, which is important for the knife. This is sharp, so it's okay. And then then up here I have as well is the knives are given an ultrasonic cleaning. Basically, the knives are dipped into a chemical solution, and they're hit with ultrasonic high-frequency sound waves. This basically breaks off any of the loud grits or any impurities that may have been left on sort of a microscopic level. It's just another finishing stage of manufacturing. And then from there, we move on to the sort of finishing stages, if you will. So as you see, this is a hand stropping process where the knives are hand sharpened on a grinding wheel by one of our factory workers. And then what I think is really important as well is that we put the knife into a laser level. What this is a quality control point for us. This is where we check the edge of the knife. We do so with this laser level. We have a very specific set of criteria that we want all of our knives to fall under as far as the angle of the edge, which I'll get into a little bit later, but you can see it's an important thing as far as having a really sharp knife goes. So we use both the handcraft and technology to make sure it's exactly the product that we want. And then from there, it gives you your final product. We attach the handle, give one more good once over, and it's ready to go, packaged in the kit. So you see that there's actually a lot of steps that go into your knife. Now, I had mentioned before what the knife is, high carbon German stainless steel, but I don't know if anyone's ever thought of actually the content of steel, what that really means. So basically, let's break it down. First of all, I said high carbon. What that means is the knife has a percentage of carbon that's over a certain amount. Generally, the benchmark for it is about 0.5% carbon. What this does is, as I said before, it makes the knife hard, gives it strength. That durability is important for holding and then also keeping an edge on the knife. So in this case, our knife is about 0.5% carbon. You'll find, especially it's nice to be on the West Coast, and there's more of a sort of Japanese influence as far as that goes. And as you become more versed in knives, you'll just undoubtedly discover Japanese knives. It's sort of a counterpoint. A lot of the really expensive, higher-end Japanese knives, they come in around about 1% carbon, which is really nice for putting a really sharp edge on it. but it is difficult to maintain that edge, and it requires a fair amount of skill and craftsmanship to maintain it. So it's more of a sort of professional level, but where we are here is we're absolutely on line with any of the other industry knives that you would see out there. Anything that you would go out and find in Williams and Sonoma or whatever, as far as high quality German steel, we have the exact same specifications in our knives. Then the other part of that I said is stainless steel. So to make a knife stainless, there's a variety of elements added to it. In this particular case, we add chromium to it, about 15% to the knife. What that does is I don't know if anyone's ever seen a carbon steel knife. If you look it up, if you go onto the internet, there's basically two different schools of thought on knives. Older knives, carbon steel knives, didn't have any of this chromium in it. And those knives were considered to be very sharp and very good, but unfortunately they tend to rust and discolor quite easily. Because it is all steel, as we all know that, you know, rust is very, very prevalent, easy form. So if something is just made of just iron, the ability for it is to rust happens very quickly and easily. So they require a lot of care. So for the sort of acidic, wet environments of the kitchen, we add chromium to it. This helps the knife really resist any sort of corrosion and whatnot. It's not to say that it will not rust, but if properly cared for, you should never see any rust on your knives. As long as they're washed properly, hand dried, and put away, that's what the chromium is there for, is to keep it from ever doing sort of rusting. All right, so a little bit of knife safety. So I know that we are sort of, you know, we're doing this like a little day seminar. Basically, cool. I know some of you are in class as well. So some things to always keep in mind as far as knife safety goes. If you are ever interested in working in the kitchen or whatever, these are some important things that we can all really appreciate. So number one, if you do have to pass a knife in the kitchen, we always want to make sure you pass the knife handle first. All right, so the person has it, and then if they're going to pass it back to you precisely, handle first. Now, if you have to do, that's fine. Ideally, the best thing to do is just to put the knife on the table and let somebody else then grab it. But if we are going to pass it handle first to everybody. If you are walking around the kitchen with your knife, we want the knife to be down to our side with the blade pointing behind us. Fairly common sense, if you are walking around and someone bumps into you, obviously there's no chance that they're going to be cut or anything. And then as an extra note, if you do ever work in a restaurant, and this is one of those things, especially for the students here, as you are moving around the kitchen with your knife, I always like to let people know, in addition to saying behind them, behind sharp. That way they know you're carrying a knife and they have a little bit more, just a little extra caution for you. So if you find yourself catering or working in the kitchen or anything like this, if you're carrying a knife in your hand, behind sharp is an important thing to sort of have in your terminology. It's the same thing if you're carrying a hot pan, you know, behind you hot, turning hot. These are sort of a little bit of lingo in our language. The idea is we always want everyone around us to be well aware of what's going on. It's, you know, it's cramped, small spaces. There's a lot of different dangerous things going on. So it's really important in our field to really be thinking about what's going on around you at all times. And that really all boils down to common sense. I mean, you know, use your head. If you think you're doing something incorrectly, then don't do it. Another part of knife safety, especially when you're on your stations, if your knife is on your station, the best way to make sure that it's protected is I like to leave mine at the top of the station and then my towel folded to the side so it's all here squared up for you. If by chance you happen to leave your towel on your table and someone grabs it by accident, it's a chance that they could be cutting. So I always want to make sure that your table and your station is always basically well organized and laid out. You don't want any extra accidents happening at the table. All right. So that's a little bit of knife safety. Now we sort of move into really the meat and potatoes of it, which is sharpening. So I have some materials up here that I want to show you how to sharpen the knives that you have. So I have with me a dull Genesis knife that I want to show you. So you can see the difference between a sharp knife and a dull knife. So a sharp knife ideally is going to be doing some really thin, precise cuts. And I don't know if anyone's ever known that basically a sharp knife is a safe knife. That's the way I feel about it. The more effort that you have to put into cutting something, if you're at home and you're, you know, fighting to cut through carrots, then there's a better chance that you're going to slip and cut yourself. So what we want to do is we want to make sure that our knives are sharp. Now there's a couple of different ways we can do that. For your home knife, home chef, and for somebody who's basically in culinary school every day, your first tool is going to be the steel. I don't know if you can see me. So the steel is basically a honing rod. But what's happening with our knives when it's dull is basically the edge comes to a very fine point, And over time, as you're using it, that edge tends to roll to one side. So the really precise edge that we want to use to sharpen knives, it's rolled, it develops some peaks and valleys. Basically, it's not as straight as we would like it to be. So what we're going to do first to sharpen our knives, and this is sort of a basic maintenance thing, is we're going to hone the knife. So we have a sharpening steel that should come in your kit. We're going to put it at about a 20 degree angle on the steel. So the best way to get there is to start at 90, go about halfway down to 45, and then halfway down again to about 20 degrees, thereabouts. So move our knife in a smooth motion down the full length of the steel.
You're not putting much pressure.
Not too much pressure, no, not at all. And then we're gonna alternate, so back and forth on each side. And for your basic use, this will be able to keep your knife in relative good sharpness, but over time, no amount of honing will keep it the way that it should be done. So we have some extra tools here in the kitchen that will help us sharpen. Yeah, it's pretty sharp, but we can do better. So I have a variety of sharpening stones with me. Number one that I highly recommend you using is right here. This is the Norton Chart sharpening stone. This is available in the school. And I always find that it's best to use the school stuff first because the chefs are here to help you make sure you're doing it right. And then also you don't have to go out and buy anything on your own necessarily right away. Yeah. So the sharpening stone has three sides to it. I don't know if anyone's ever familiar with doing any home sharpening. So there are, the sides are labeled as according to their coarseness or their grit, if you will. And that's basically the density of the stone. After we're done with this, you guys can all come down here and I can show you up close as well. So, you know, you can listen and then I can show you up here. So the coarse side is exactly that. It's a little bit of a coarser grit. This would be used to sort of repair any damaged nicks or any problems that are in the blade itself. The next side is really nice, the medium side. So it's a little bit finer. It's a little bit smoother on your finger if you were to touch it. And as far as most of your sharpening goes with your knives out of your kits, unless you're really beating the snot out of them doing things like cutting up bones or whatever, I stick to the medium and the fine grits. Those are really, that's all you need as far as sharpening goes. And then the last one here, as I said, is the fine grits. So this is what's going to help us put a really nice edge on our knife so it's super sharp. So the procedure is more or less the same for sharpening as it is for steeling. The idea is that we want to have it at about a 20 degree angle. That's what our knives are manufactured to, is between about a 16 and a half and 20 degree angle for the cuts. We find that the finer, the more acute the angle edge, the really the sharper and better performing the knife is, which is a good thing for you. Out of the kits, the knives are really sharp. But to sharpen them properly, it does require a little bit of finesse and a little bit of technique. Actually, one of my favorite things to show off is this is a knife that I bought right out of culinary school. So I got my knife from culinary school and I liked it. But one day I was in the kitchen at work and the chef tried to use it to cut something and threw it down a flight of stairs because he didn't like how sharp it was. So I went out and bought something. And this is my first knife that I bought at culinary school, and I was really, really exuberant about sharpening it. Unfortunately, I didn't have very good technique. So this is what happened to it. I don't know if you can see it up there, but basically there's a gap between the heel of the knife down here and the board. I did what's called eagle clawing to the knife. I ruined it. So if you look at it now, it doesn't fit. It doesn't sit on the cutting board properly. So this is an example that I like to use, especially for school and everything, is that, you know, now I get paid to do this for a living, but this is where I came from, not knowing how to do it at all. So really, good technique is absolutely key for a lot of things you do in the kitchen, and it's really important skill to have. So, you know, start someplace and move from there. All right, so now how are we going to sharpen this knife properly? So this guy is pretty dull as far as I'm concerned. What we're going to do is we want to sharpen the full length of the blade. We want to use the full area of the sharpening stone to do so. So what we're going to do is we're going to start with the tip of our knife down here at the bottom left-hand corner. We want to finish with the heel of the knife here at the top left corner. So it's going to be one smooth motion, trying to use the full length of the stone to sharpen the full length of the knife. What this does is we're going to use and wear the stone fully. That way all the students who come behind you will have a nice piece of equipment to use as well. I've seen plenty of schools or people in professionally, they use just one little part of the stone and it ends up looking like a skateboard half pipe. It's a lot harder to use, so that's really important. What we're going to use to lubricate these stones, we have a kitchen grade honing oil. This usually accompanies the oil that you have, this usually accompanies the stones, so this is what I would recommend using on these guys. I also have, if you want to do sharpening at home, this is an Arizona whetstone. You can find this in most restaurants and appliance stores. It has a coarser grit and also has a finer grit. This is about $45-$50, so if you're interested in doing some home sharpening, this is a good place to start for you. For most of these American whetstones, I think oil is the best lubricant of choice. You can usually find a food grade oil to go along with it as well. And then once you really start getting into the field and you want to be professional, these are the next thing to consider. This is a Japanese water stone. This is sort of the highest level of sharpening, if you will. These are very expensive and very brittle stones. And what you're doing is basic physics tells you that when you apply force to something, it pushes back with equal and opposite force. So these stones are extremely dense. The idea being is that on a molecular level, when we push onto these knives, when we have proper alignment and technique, the stone will push back a lot harder because it's so dense. And that's what's going to align the molecules of the blade on sort of a molecular level. That's what we're doing. If you really have to think about what cutting is basically using a really high amount of force in a very small area. So if you remember that old equation from physics, it's that force equals mass over area. So if I'm taking a knife that has, say for instance, maybe like a 1/16 of an inch, and I'm applying 10 pounds of force on it, under that area, if you do the math or whatever, you can see that it's basically a couple hundred pounds of force per square inch. The idea being is that we're cleaning things on an atomic level, so the sharper and the more fine your edges, the lot more precise your strokes can be. So, again, the procedure for that is we're going to go down to a 20 degree angle, so start at 90, go about halfway down to 45, and then halfway down to 20. Alright, so the tip of the knife, bottom left corner, and then the heel of the knife finishing up here. The motion goes like this. When I sharpen, I like to do 5 or 6 strokes on each side, and then switch over. And as you are getting used to sharpening, there's a couple of different tools you can use. I actually found this in the sharpener. It's pretty neat. This is an angle guide, so what you can do is you can put it here and it can help you set your angle for when you're sharpening. Another way to be able to do it is I find most of the time about the height of your pinky is about the right height for that 16 to 20 degree angle. But, you know, just practice going halfway, then halfway again, and then you can get a general feel for it. And that's really the hardest thing about sharpening is keeping that proper angle the whole time as you're sharpening. It's kind of a muscle memory thing. So it's good to practice on something else. Like if you have an elevated box or something like that, you can practice running that angle on it. That's a good way to do it as well. But anyway, so we want to do it. I did 4 or 5 times on this side. We also, of course, want to sharpen both sides of the blade because these are double-sided knives. So we'll start here, same thing, same angle. Moving across the length. There's actually a fair amount of oil pulled up in the bottom here, so I'm just going to use this. But do keep the surface well lubricated as you're using it. Otherwise, there could be a tendency for it to actually scratch the blade. Alright, again on this side, probably about 12 strokes overall. If you have any questions, please by all means holler them at me right now as well.
If you're using the stone at home, if you bought a stone for home, do you just put that down on the counter?
Yeah, exactly. The best way to secure a stone at home is to get a kitchen towel, some of these things. I don't know if you can find a restaurant supply or an old rag. Exactly, yeah. Just get the towel a little bit wet, and then put it on a cutting board or on a surface, because it'll hold, it'll grip pretty well. Yeah, that's fine. And then if you're gonna, if you are, go out and buy the water stones. They obviously need to be soaked in water and then kept lubricated the whole time. So, yeah, doing that on a kitchen rag is good. But yeah, something to anchor it. Some of them say that they'll self-anchor, but it's not what you want to be doing. All right, so we're gonna move to the finer grit side. Procedure is exactly the same. So we're just gonna make sure that we're getting a really nice edge on our knife. Just on this side here. Again, that 20 degrees is key. Tip of the knife here, bottom corner, finishing with the heel here.
How much pressure are you putting down?
The pressure that I'm putting on it, I usually can't do the amount of pressure you use, like push open a screen door. So you're not like putting your full weight into it, but a little bit of force. What's nice about it is because the stone is very dense, that you'll feel the grip of the blade on there. So you just kind of want to maintain that. Just enough force to sort of maintain even pressure and boom. But when you come down here, and you can demonstrate, I can show you, you can get a feel for how much you need to use. More strokes, we should be good. And one of the questions I get a lot, and probably been around someone's mind, is how often do you run your knives on the sharpening stones? And to answer that is it really varies. As you get to know your knives better, you'll really know when they're starting to become less sharp and not as sharp as you would like them to be. So it's really a usage thing. If you find yourself, if you're in class with the students, you find yourself always on stock duty and you're constantly chopping your bar and the like, then you're going to sharpen your stone a little bit sooner than someone who ends up just doing like a lot of fine dice on vegetables. You should probably be stealing once or twice a day. As you're using your knife, you feel the edge start to go a little bit, steal away, and then it will be time eventually, probably after a good month or so, a month or 2 weeks. It really depends on how you're using the knife, though, but if you feel that it's starting to get super dull, ask your chef, and he'll be able to tell you if it's time. Or if he tries to use your knife in class and uses someone else's, then it's probably time to sharpen. I've come from a lot of schools that I go see. There's one or two of those favorite students who the chef always uses their knives. And I was like, that's good. You know, that's how they know they like you, is if they use your knife. They may not necessarily talk to you, but they will definitely go to use your knife or whatever. All right. So we should be good. I like to finish mine with a couple of strokes on the steel. Just get a final grit on it. Another thing that I like to mention as well is, I don't know if anyone here is a tremendous home cook, but if you are, you may want to consider getting one of these as well. This is a diamond steel. So as opposed to this one, which is just grooved stainless, this steel actually has a fine powder coating of diamond on the outside. The idea being diamond is a harder substance on demand, so that it grits the knife a little better. It will actually do a little bit of sharpening for the blade as well. So this is really my favorite for finishing it on. And for your smaller blades, like for your paring knives, I would never really worry about putting them on the stone. Having something like this around is really good for putting an edge back on your paring knife.
Is there any correlation of the paring knife lose its sharpness a little more quickly than the chef's knife? Just the size doesn't matter.
Not really. It's all about the edge and what you're using it for. The steel on our paring knives, the one that you have in your kit, is the exact same steel as we use with the chef knives. Everything about it is the same, it's just the length and the size. So it depends on what you're doing. But yeah, so now we have a knife that I think is pretty honky sharp. I can always go, I'll do the test of tests for us, actually. If someone has a piece of paper, I'll find a piece of paper. Not necessarily. You can change the oil as long as it's all self-contained here. Because this is a food-grade oil, so it doesn't really break down. There's not any sort of thing about it. So if you're going to use one at school, as long as it's all sort of taken care of and put away, that's fine. For your home-use one, it's going to get, as you're using oil for lubricants, it's just going to get oily. That's the nature of it. So just putting it someplace, it's sealed, it's wrapped up, it's covered. It's usually fine. Bacteria. The least thing we're trying to do is avoid bacteria. So as long as we use food grade oil or something like that, it's
just like
Well, no, I mean, you could if you were in a pinch use canola oil. This is something different. I don't know exactly what it's made out of, but it's anything that's food grade, as long as it says food grade oil on there, that's really what you're going for. So, this knife should hopefully ideally. Oops. Exactly what we're looking for, is to just cut ribbons of paper. So, yeah, it would be a sharp knife. All right, so now that the knife has been fully sharpened, the knife is good to go, it's ready for you. The last thing we want to consider is how we handle the knife, how we put it away, basically. So, as you may or may not do with your knives at home, these knives are all to be washed by hand, warm soapy water, and never spend any time in the dish tank. For a couple of reasons. First of all, if you put it through the dishwasher here at the school or at home, there's a good chance that someone behind you could grab it and cut and hurt themselves. Number one. And then number two, some of the detergents that are in the soap and whatnot can damage the finish on your knife, and they can shorten the life of it. So our knives are best when they are hand washed, hand dried, and then put away in your cases. I don't know if you guys have these or not as well. These are a good thing to consider picking up. These are really expensive knife guards, so these are a good thing to get for your knives, because then you can put them away and you don't have to worry about them ever banging into each other or dropping or falling things. So I use these as well. These are really good. And then you can get all of our stuff online if you're interested in sort of enhancing your kit. They can buy things from the bookstore, correct? So the bookstore would be good as well. And there's also a website called digitalwarehouse.com. We retail our stuff for there. And if you use the promo code SHARPEN, you get 10% off as well. So good thing to know. So that's pretty much it as far as I have for sharpening and the demo. But I, of course, I'm happy to answer questions, sir.
I just have a question. The knife that you were sharpening it, you were saying that one has a double edge on it, like you were sharpening both sides. But I've seen like Japanese chef knives that only
Absolutely.
Have an edge on one side.
It's
What's
true.
The purpose of that?
So with the Japanese knives, it really is to understand the cutlery, is to understand the cuisine. So obviously they eat a lot of raw fish, and a lot of really, really artistically produced items. So as far as the cuisine goes, they want something that is ridiculously sharp, and it's really going to be doing a lot of fine slicing and cutting. So they don't really do a lot of heavy chopping and the like as far as things go. So what they want from their knives is that really that precision cut. So how the knives are generally manufactured is a whole world of knives. It goes beyond our stuff, which is really, really cool. But we are actually developing a line of Japanese knives as well that will be purchased soon. Anyway, so their knives are generally carbon steel. So that is susceptible to discoloration and rust. They require a lot of care and maintenance to keep an eye on them. What's generally done is they have a core of carbon steel, and then they're wrapped in a stainless steel composite around the outside. That way, the whole knife itself doesn't rust. What that basically does, if you've ever looked at the edge of it, is it forms like two bevels, and where that first bevel starts is where the outer metal coating stops. So the cutting edge itself that's exposed is that carbon steel. And then what they do with the knives is that basically one end is slightly concave, and then the other side is a cutting edge to it. This gets really results in a really superior cut. You can get something that is literally like 1 or 2 microns wide at the blade tip. So that's their style for doing it. The idea is again that single-sided Japanese blade is really about long, thin, very precise, sharp cuts. It's not going to necessarily work too well for trying to chop vegetables.
So yes, yeah, so you can't like chop carrots with it, but you can slice fish.
I would certainly not do it because you yeah.
Can you sharpen a bone knife?
I can't sharpen a bone knife. I'm happy to show it to you. That's actually one thing I'm glad you asked me about. So, when it comes to sharpening sort of your otter-shaped knives, the procedure is exactly the same as is the technique. You just need to change it a little bit. So she asked me about the boning knife that you guys have in your kit as well. It's a little bit different shape, so it does require a little bit of finesse. So. Again, the technique is the same, the 20-degree angle, and then we want to make sure that we're sharpening along the full length of the blade. So it's exactly the same. I'm starting with the tip here, I'm finishing with the heel up here. It's just a little bit different. I'm gonna basically swing my arm out a little bit. So I'm gonna go like this, and then move down a little bit. So really, the only difference between it and the chef knife is that you just have to basically keep the blade in contact with the stone the whole time. So everything about it is the same, except that you have to maneuver just to the shape of the knife. That's really the only difference to it is that you want to move
to adjust the shape of the knife. Other than that, everything about it is exactly the same.
Can
serrated knives cannot be sharpened by anything you see here. You can send them out to be sharpened, but to be honest with you, it's difficult because you're basically having someone go through and hand sharpen each of the individual tines, and it's difficult. And if you are sending it out, chances are they're just running it through a machine, which is doing sharpening, but it's not them. We actually are hopefully going to come out with a tool soon, basically a little ceramic file, so that you can take the time and go into each of the individual teeth. But it's a long, laborious process, exactly. But what's nice about it, I'm not sure which chef knife you are, which slicing knife you have, but whichever one's in your kit is really good. I really like the slicers that we have, whether it's the short one, which is I think is our Genesis line, a different line, or the Millennia, which I think is when you have that hard rubber handle. That slicer is a really good slicer. I had one, I loved it. I found it in a friend's toolkit and I was like, do you want this? You know, I'll take it. It's a great, great knife, so yeah. So it should stay sharp for a while. Yeah. But it is a harder one to do. Any other questions I can answer for you guys?
What was the website again?
Digital Warehouse?
Cooking District.
I'm sorry, Cooking District, excuse me, I'm totally wrong. Cooking District, sorry.
District,
yeah. We just changed over, so that's something to yeah. Any other questions I can answer? Like I said, restaurant business, thank you, sir.
What are your views on those small hand, knife sharpeners that have a little,
I personally have never used them. And really, as far as anything sharpening goes, as long as it's getting your knife sharp the way you want it, go for it. I think personally that because this is one of those last fields where it's really about technique and artistry and artisanal crafting and a lot of things, I prefer to do everything by hand. And I think that you can really get the best results when you learn sort of exactly what you're going for. If you say, for instance, prefer a little bit of more of a lower degree, a little bit, a higher acute angle with your sharpening, then you can control that. With those things, it's just factory spec as far as an angle goes. Right. So I personally prefer to do everything on myself by hand. But if you're in a hurry, I can definitely be a tool for you. Absolutely.
Thank you, Chris. We know we have some students who need to get back and do some more knife cutting and knife skills, so we need to do the raffle. So who would like to, everybody's got a ticket?
Yes, Chef.
Yes, Chef.
Right. Sure. So we have a multitude of prizes to give away. And because nothing in life is free, as I call your name, I need you to remind me either of safety, the handling, or anything that you learned from today's skit, or today's spiel, so I'm going to show that. Just, it's like check number 807-394. I'll give you my number. All right.
If you're using a stone at home, you can put them on a discount to the website.
precisely. 807, 376.
All right. Do it again now. So I'm not going to put you on the spot.
Okay.
Where's all the steel from?
I was thinking of the same thing.
Okay, where's all our steel from? It's
Germany.
No, I'm just teasing. I know it's early. I know it's early. It's good. 807-387. All right. A nice little reference guide for it. So it has a bunch of stuff.
Be mine sharp.
Excellent. 807, 367.
I like the tip, in addition to the steel, that you could purchase a diamond coated.
It's true. It's really good for sharpening home knives. Don't eagle claw your knives. It's true. Good technique, just like anything else. Good technique. All right, and for our last prize. 807-364.
All right. If you're handing your knife to somebody, you might consider just putting it on a flat surface and having them get it.
Excellent.
I love this.
Well, some of my friends today, thank you. If you have extra time, I'll be up here. I can work on your sharpening technique with you, and I can answer any of the questions you have if you want to go to the front. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.